Hey peeps, so I haven't done this recent watch stuff in a while, so I thought I'd make a quick video of a couple of movies I've seen. One from 2011 and a newer film released this year. So let's start with Venom: Let There Be Carnage. So a little background of my experience with these Venom movies. I couldn't even finish the first one. After 30 minutes, I was just done. I don't understand why Sony is so stingy with not letting the rights go straight to Disney after what they've accomplished with Marvel property. I've come to accept that Sony will never change. So going into this movie, I had no expectations, and on top of that, the first 10-ish minutes bored the crap out of me to where I even dozed off a few times in the theater. And from there, I was bored various times throughout the movie. You know, I can't even take Venom being a protagonist seriously, especially when he tells Brock that being responsible is obsolete, which explains why he's so set on protecting everyone in the city. As far as Venom and Eddie's relationship is concerned in the film, I knew exactly where this was all going, and I was right. Their chemistry was slightly more watchable than the first one, but not enough to make me invested. But at that point, I was wondering why even go that direction they did in this film when the relationship has no weight or depth to it. Heck, Peter Parker's relationship with his alter ego Spider-Man was given more dimension in Spider-Man 2, and his suit didn't even talk. Now, I only went to see this because Woody Harrelson is in this, and he's one of my favorite actors, and now I regret it. Harrelson gave the weirdest, most unnatural performance of his entire career. It sort of reminded me of Eddie Redmayne from Jupiter Ascending in terms of him not really being sure what he was going for himself, and Carnage wasn't even a character in this movie. He was just an obstacle. At the very least, Eddie and Venom's relationship had some sort of definition to it, but Cassidy and Carnage had nothing. I mean, you can argue that that's the point, but the movie just plays this straight without actually acknowledging it, until the end of the movie, of course. The way Cassidy even becomes Carnage has to be the cheapest, laziest, most rushed, and poorly thought out idea ever put on a page for pre-production. And Carnage just looks like a big blob of CGI when under high degrees of lighting. When in the dark, he looks decent, I guess. I can say the exact same thing for Venom, which explains why these action scenes take place in the night anyway. And once Carnage and Venom actually fight, there's pretty much nothing to be invested in. It just looks like two CGI messes just having sex with each other, like seriously. So yeah, the plot was just incredibly predictable, and I pretty much predicted what was going to happen in the first 10 minutes of this movie. And the villain's motivations were not remotely interesting to me, and one of the reasons why I was really bored. There are so many stupid things that happen in this movie that I might just say screw it and do a full review at some point, but I've only seen this movie once and I barely remember most of it anyway. So yeah, this movie was pretty bad, not harmful, just not something I cared for. Maybe Sony should just be humble and give the rights back to Disney, since Spider-Man and Venom's dynamic makes more sense than if Spider-Man wasn't there at all. So final rating, 1 out of 5, I guess. I don't know. And I also saw Once Upon a Time in Anatolia from 2011, directed by Nuri Bilge Ceylan. Now, I wanted to watch Winter's Sleep, but I never got to it before my movie subscription attached to my Amazon made me rent it. But I still have it on my watch list, and especially after this movie, I'm really interested in Ceylan's work. Anatolia's pacing is unconventional, but the film is atmospheric, immersive, unsettling, and just plain gorgeous. This is a neo-noir film, and the first half takes place at night, and the other half takes place during the day. Despite the film's grounded setting though, there's a certain degree of surrealness that fleshes out the characters in the story. I also love how the film's atmosphere almost causes you to be able to breathe it at times. Now, my only issue with this movie is that there's a certain level of coldness to it, and the second half, while still satisfying and meaningful, didn't really have the same level of engagement as the first half, but I still really like this movie a lot, and while very unconventional, it was still a good watch, and I can't wait to dive into his other films. So, a 3.8 out of 5 stars. Alright, that's all I have for now. I'll keep you all in the loop, and peace out and love y'all.